funny is when I just came in, I saw that there was a big competition going on here. And I noticed that they were giving out prizes and everything. And I thought to myself, so I said, "Self, when was the last time you won a prize for anything?" And I said, not in a long time. So I came prepared. You know, there's a hat competition. That's what y'all have. Well, guess what? None of the other men have their hats. So I brought my own. So I know I got myself a prize, right? Ladies and gentlemen, it's a beautiful evening, isn't it? I'm Reverend sendtohope, as was said earlier on, and yes, sendtohope is my real name. When I was a kid, my mom, she talked to me, you know, she said, my dad, he named me sendtohope. So I thought to myself, why would somebody name their kid sendtohope? You know, that's a funny name. You know, a lot of people think I'm Haitian, because I said sendtohope, but no, I'm Jamaican. And big up all my Jamaican folks. You know, I asked her, I said, why did he name me sendtohope? She said, well, you know what? When you were born, and I told him I was gonna have a kid, he said, I hope. And then he stopped. So I thought, really, what was that about? But then I get to understand, you know, not every man can deal with the whole I'm pregnant issue. So he was sort of hoping it wasn't true. No, for real. I don't know what the problem was, but I think he didn't really like me. Because when I was a baby, my mom, she said, oh, he's so cute. Look at this beautiful baby. What a treasure. And my father said, good, let's bury it. But I'm doing good. I'm a youth pastor at the Open Bible Community Church down there in Miami. And you know, I'm a father, so I named my son sendtohope as well. Because I said, I'm not going through life with that name alone. Somebody has got to get that name. They used to tease me at school. I said, you need to take some teasing too. No, but for real though, I really love my wife. She's here with me, she's outside. And my son, I love him to death. I remember when he was born, I got so excited, you know, I grabbed the phone, I called 911, I said, hello, you know, I send the ambulance, my wife is having a baby, you know, send him right now. And the lady, she was very, very nice on the phone. She said, calm down, sir, we're going to do our best, we're going to send an ambulance and everything is going to be okay. She said, is this her first child? I said, no, it's her husband. Really? I mean, she was kind and everything, but she was not too smart. You know? But I love Jesus, and you know, I make no apologies for that. Everybody in here love Jesus. Put your hands up. Amen. Hallelujah. You know, today I was at church. I preached today. The message was very important, you know, especially for my young people. I talked to them about health, you know, and how to keep your body healthy and everything. And, you know, part of what I said to them, you know, you got to stay away from red meat and pork and certain of those type of meat. They're not healthy for you. You know, I told my young people, I said, pork is one of those meats that it contains a certain oil that's called lard. And you have to be careful that because that oil doesn't leave your body. And then one gentleman got up and said, Pastor, I don't know about you, but we love the Lord. I couldn't say nothing. I switched the conversation. I started telling them, I said, okay, you know what? Stay away from drugs. Stay away from strong drink. You know, don't drink that beer. Don't buy that rum. I said, if it was up to me, I would have taken all the rum, I'd put them in a barrel, and I'd throw them in the river. And the same man, he got up and said, shall we gather round the room? This was one Sunday that it was just hard for me. It was really hard for me. But God is good. She makes you feel comfortable as a man. I don't know about all the men in here. I see all slim guys in here. I don't have a problem saying, you know, that I got some weight around the midsection. She said, amen, hallelujah. She said, son, she said, you gotta eat less, you know? And that's good advice. I say you gotta cook less, you know? And my wife, she does an excellent job. And I know there's some young kids here, but I'm gonna say this, and I want everybody to listen carefully. The best thing about my wife is that she's an excellent stripper. I'm talking about Kalalu. I don't know what y'all are thinking. She strips Kalalu very well. My breakfast is always good. You got some, you know, check your thoughts. It's Sunday, check your thoughts. I'm gonna pray for you. But you know we're in Miami, and Miami is an excellent city.
Yeah.
I mean, big up to all the persons in Broward, you know, all the folks in Broward, big up. But we got some crazy folks in Dade.
Yeah.
You know, and you know, some of the folks will be like, yeah, I ain't going down there. You know, I don't know. I came to America and all of a sudden, Miami-Dade is the ghetto. But one of the things that's crazy in Miami is the multicultural. You know, I like it. I like the fact that I wake up in the morning and my neighbors are some Haitians and just around the corner there are some Spanish folks, you know. But when I put my hat on, I sort of look Spanish too. So when I go into Hialeah and places like those, you know, they talk Spanish to me. And sometimes it's a little bit, you know, crazy. I went into the bank the other day and I said, hello, good morning. Somebody said, buenos dias. I said, no, I English. And she said, you're bilingual? I said, no, I don't buy nothing. If you're giving it free, I'll take it. Because you know the Jamaicans, we take it free. You know? But after a while, I got around to telling them, you know, talking to people, I give them a little bit of Spanish, you know. She said, buenos dias. I said, no quiero Taco Bell. But we are Jamaicans, we stand out. Wherever we go, we stand out. And I always say this, every time I'm doing a comedy set, I say this, and it may be funny, but it's the truth. We as Jamaicans have a lot to be proud of. Things may not be so okay at home. And we need, you know, folks who are here to remember home, the island, you know. But this is something that I've always said. As Jamaicans, we didn't wet our foot to come into this country. We didn't crawl under tunnels to come into this country. We didn't stow away on any boat to come into this country. We came through the airport. We had our carry-on behind us. We dressed nice. We had our head up high. We go up to the custom officer and he said, how long you staying? We said, 2 weeks. Some people, 2 weeks are 20 years. The other day in Lauder Hill, somebody said immigration on 441. 441 empty. Not even bus stop. we come here, you know, I spoke about this recently. For the folks who are living here, who has been here for over 20 years, whatever, when you have family and friends in Jamaica, and we talk to them on the phone, some of us, we say, come on up for a visit, man, come on. I think we need to tell them the truth, that they only can spend 2 weeks. The first week, we're gonna take them shopping. We take them to the mall. And then we take them to the Chinese buffet. Because we're gonna give them food, but we don't wanna pay a lot. The second week, we're gonna go back to work. We're gonna leave them at the house. When we come home in the evening, we're looking around because we're expecting that they do something while they're there. If they're there for the third week, oh, all hell is gonna break loose. Now we start coming home as we, by the time the car pulls in the driveway, we mad. Because we know they're in the house. So we come in, we go straight to the fridge. Who drink off the orange juice? We go look at the AC. How the AC runs up. We start to say to them after that, listen, you can't just see in the holes. So, you have to go and look something to do. That's us. We need to tell them the truth. You only got 2 weeks. So, most of our Jamaicans, when we come up, we want to do something because we want a little change in our pocket. We independent. I got a friend who, he got up and he said, listen, I'm going to go get something to do. And he went up. And he went and he got a job. A little man called me one day and said, you know, I want you to do me a favor. I got some paint here, and I want you to go around the back and paint the back porch for me. My Jamaican friend, he said, yes, man, thank you very much, Mr. D. I'm gonna go paint the porch. And he go around the back and he paint. And when he come back around, the little man said, you finished? He said, yes, man, I'm quite finished. He had a little paint on him, but that was okay. The man took out some money and he gave him. And he said, thank you very much. And the Jamaican, my friend, he said, thank you, sir. But I have one thing to say to you, sir. It's not a porch, it's a BMW. No, we're Jamaican. We're gonna do that thing. We're gonna make that work. We're Jamaican. And when we come here, whatever it means to make it work, we're gonna make it work. A friend of mine, he called me the other day, said, listen, man, send to him, not one. Make reports of ourselves on fruits. So he got a cart, and me and him opened up on the road. We sell fruits. Going to the neighborhoods and say, apple, banana, orange. And we're going around selling our fruits. Out of the blues, a car come around the corner with a drunken man, hit the cart and send all the fruits up in the air, everything mash up and drop. Me look on him look on me. We say, what we ever do now? The man say, hey, my thing now go down, so you know. Fruit salad. I woke up the other day, my neighbor, Jamaican guy, good guy. But he takes things a little bit too literal. Good Jamaican guy, but he takes things so literal. So I see him outside, he walking on the road. I thought he was out for a morning walk. But then I see him walking, then he jump. Walking, then he jump. I said, it looked like Owen the Bank crack. So I go up to him, being a goodly neighbor, being a Christian. I said, oh, well, everything all right? He said, yes, man, the good man. He said, you're sure? He said, yes, man, me did feel a little weird. A couple of days ago, I got a doctor, you know. So I said,
Someone want to know. He said, oh, the doctor gave me some medication. And he said, take two today and skip tomorrow.
See, I'm a pastor, and sometimes it's really hard, especially for us as pastors. It's worse when we start a prayer for you. But no, to be real, some of the pastors are prayer for you. I had an assistant pastor the other day leave the church, and he left, you know, we bid him farewell and stuff, but he had a problem with his belly. So he used to go to this little church lady's house, you know, little old lady. He went to her house every time communion, he brings she communion. He don't want nobody else to go to that lady's house. So we were sort of suspicious, yet to find out that every time he went, the woman, she would prepare a nice spread for him. Drinks, food, everything. But he especially liked a bowl of mixed nuts that she always put out. So one day he went, there was no nuts. He goes to her, he says, Sister Claire, I noticed that you don't put on no mixed nuts. You don't have a problem with me eating the nuts, you know? She said, no, Pastor. You can get them anytime, but you see, I don't have any. You see, my daughter, she sent them from New York, but she not send them in a little while. But you can have them. She said, this is the problem, Pastor. I don't have no teeth. So, when the peanut and the mixed nuts come, I just suck on the chocolate and put the nuts in the door. Especially as a pastor. One day, he came to church, and a little church sister brought him a bowl of Sprat. So he put the Sprat in the vestry. Is the vestry in here, right? Something like that. In the back room. But he makes sure that his eye on the Sprat. Because he don't want nobody to go in there and take this Sprat. So he go in and he make sure. And just as he started preaching, a little cat jumped through the window. And he up here preaching and trying to find the cat. But the cat not pay him any mind. He draw near, he said, ladies and gentlemen, the enemy is like a roaring lion, seeking who he may devour. But sometime him coming like a puss. You can't pray for me as a minister. Just before I leave you, I want to say to you, you're looking beautiful tonight. You're looking wonderful tonight. But not everybody. See, I have a problem because some people try to pretend that you don't have ugly people. But you have ugly people. And some of the worst things that ugly people do is that they give themselves and then pick the pretty people near. You ever see a little ugly baby, and the mother said, come Denzel, and she said, come Halle Berry, and you're like, what was she thinking?
But as I give up the mic, as I said before, there are some good-looking people here, and there are some ugly ones. If you want to see who is ugly, look at the person inside of him. Let me tell you what really bad. The wife them looking upon the husband them, and the husband looks straight ahead. Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a beautiful evening. Thank you very much. God bless you, gentlemen.